bishops of North America, they gathered together and they released a statement regarding the martyrdom of Abuna Sam'an Shahata. Archie will read the statement now.
From October 17th to 20th in 2017, we, the Coptic Orthodox Bishops of North America, gathered in our semi-annual conference at Titusville, Florida, to discuss the acts of sectarian violence directed against our beloved brothers in Egypt. The most recent of these events resulted in the martyrdom of Higumen Sam'an Shahata from the Diocese of Bina and Al-Fashin. We joyfully commend the righteous soul of this father, the martyr Higumen Sam'an Shahata, to the paradise of joy, confident that the Lord will accept his soul with those whom St. John the Beloved witnessed beneath the altar. As he states in the book of Revelation, quote, "When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge to avenge our blood on those who dwell on earth? Then the white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brothers, who would be killed as they were, was complete." End quote. We pray that the Lord bestow on his heavenly comfort upon Father Sam'an's virtuous wife, his children, his friends, and the beloved congregation of Christ through the prayers of our Father, His Holiness Pope Tuadros, and his partner in the apostolic ministry, His Grace Bishop Stephanos, and all our honorable brothers and metropolitans and bishops. We take this opportunity to affirm the following. First, the martyrdom of Higumen Sam'an Shahata is not an isolated event, but is one incident in a chain of recurrent events that has resulted in the loss of lives of countless martyrs and the injury of many confessors, both clergy and laity. The following are examples, just to name a few. The events at Al-Arish, Libya, St. Peter's Cathedral in Cairo, St. Mark's Cathedral in Alexandria, St. George's Cathedral in Tanta, St. Samuel's Monastery, and many others. These are all results of the evil of organized terrorism, targeting Christians, entrenched in an ideology of religious extremism and perforated by a fatwa, a religious opinion, emanating from a spirit of hate. Such a fatwa promotes fanaticism, violence, and discrimination against others. Second, we recognize the admirable efforts of President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi and many honorable Muslims who reject injustice and persecution and the persecution of their Coptic brothers, and deny the use of religion as a justification for these wicked and unpardonable acts. Third, we call upon all the authorities in our beloved Egypt to deal with these criminal acts with all swiftness, severity, and justice in order to serve as an example to others without bias or compromise. We ask that the law be applied to all without preferential treatment based on religious faith, and in such a way that brings a decisive end to the brutal voices that encourage violence against Christians. These voices are embodied in those who call for a less stringent punishment for a Muslim murderer if the victim is a Christian, because under the premise that the Christian blood is less valuable. Fourth, we are deeply concerned about the reputation of our beloved Egypt and perceive any blemish on her reputation as a direct consequence of whitewashing, dismissing or belittling these crimes and the lack of media coverage. We are dismayed that Egypt, which served as a refuge and harbor for the Holy Family, became the site of the murder of an innocent, unarmed priest in broad daylight, a heinous crime, which took place without any reaction from bystanders or intervention of witnesses, and with the inexcusable delay in the arrival of emergency services. All these shameful shortcomings are widely shared in social media. Fifth, terrorism is a worldwide problem that necessitates worldwide collaboration, as stated by President el-Sisi. Thus, we, the children of the Coptic Orthodox Church of North America, are compelled to increase our efforts throughout the Western world in raising awareness about the dangers of organized terrorism targeting Christians. We call for solidarity in aiding our motherland and President el-Sisi in confronting it in an unrelenting manner. Six, we call upon all of our churches to dedicate this Sunday to pray for all of our martyrs, confessors, their families, and for the peace of the church and the entire world. May the Lord grant the whole world his peace and repose, the souls of the martyrs, comfort their families and their beloved, heal all the wounded and injured, and support all the confessors to endure these pains and sufferings. And glory be to His Majesty forever. Amen. It is signed by His Eminence Metropolitan Serapion, Bishops Yusuf, David, Michael, Mina, Karas, Peter, Abraham, Kurolos, and Fathers Seraphim in Suriani.
They are ascetic deacons. They like to sit on the floor. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. We are going to dedicate our speech today for martyrdom because our church, still in the 21st century, still we offer martyrs to prove the truth of our faith. And in spite of we, on the 21st century, we talk about different rights, even there is animal rights, but we still consecrated, persecuted for our faith. I wanna start with what St. Justin the Martyr said. The more persecuted or crucified or cast into fire, they never denied their faith, and more people believed in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So if the devil tried to scare the believers by creating this events which hurt people and kill people, but the more this happens, the more people believe in Christ, and as long as well as they never deny their Christianity. That's why I can say martyrdom was the motive for the spread of Christianity. If I look to the early ages, when the Christians started to be persecuted in Jerusalem, they moved north to Antioch, and from Antioch they spread into the whole Roman Empire, north and south. They came to Egypt and they went north, as you know. And the martyrdom was a blessing for the church to spread the Christianity. I will take an example from your life. When you have test, what you do? You quit school or you study? You study, right? Why? Because you have a test. And martyrdom was a test for our faith. That's why the people, they accepted it joyfully, and they offered their life for the sake of their love of the Lord Jesus Christ. If I want to start the story from the beginning, Jesus, he showed us this way. He offered himself as a sacrifice of love. He was without sin, accepted to be crucified for us. And he told us, if you want to be my disciple, you need to deny yourself, carry your cross, and follow me. And the cross, in its deep meaning, means death. Death from sin, death from anything separates us from God. The disciples, they followed the steps of their beloved Lord. How many of the disciples got killed in a different way? How many? All of them except one. All of them except one. And the more the emperors used to put stress on the church, the more the Christianity will spread. And the church focused the eyes of the believers on heaven, seeing the crowns already in heaven for the martyrs. Imagine at the beginning of the ages of the martyrdom, the rulers discovered very strange fact. If they decide to kill the believers are very joyful. They go and dress up and they prepare themselves to be in the presence of the Lord. That's why they started another era of torturing the believers. Instead of killing them directly, they started to invent new techniques to let them suffer a lot before they kill them. Because for them, to kill them is a kind of, you are giving them a crown of martyrdom. And this is reflection to what the Lord Jesus Christ said in John 12, most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone, but if it dies, it produces much grain. If you read the history of the martyrs, you will see this event happening every time. What's happening? One of the martyrs, I'll take Saint Damiana for example. They tortured her, and the more they torture her, the people who are watching this, they confess their faith. We are Christian, and you hear that the ruler decided to kill all of them. So imagine their faith, their strong, steadfast in their faith was a courage to let others believe in this. Then the question will come, why do Christians tolerate persecution and martyrdom? Recently, I saw a TV program, and the guy is saying, I don't understand, who are you Christians? How you accept this? How you accept this? They don't know the reasons we're going to talk about. Number one, Christianity offered a new understanding for pain and suffering. Pain and suffering for human being related to the body. But for us, it is different meaning. What is the meaning of pain and suffering for the sake of your faith in Christianity? Anybody can help me? It is a torture? It is a pain? No. You will be surprised. It is a spiritual gift. It is a gift. It's not for everybody. See, pain is not related to the body, but has a spiritual meaning connected to the love of Christ. And we know the true love, that I tolerate pain for others or for the one I love. And the great school for this is the mothers. The mothers, they suffer a lot for the sake of their kids. Right? And they do this willingly or they do this unwillingly? They do it willingly with love. And because we love Christ, we accept to be in the same route of the crucifixion like him. That's why the cross became a sign of glory, victory, and love, which conquered death. Now, for them, the persecution and killing and martyrdom is not death. It is a release from life limited on earth to life unlimited in heaven, to glorification, to crowning, to be with the Lord, because we believe that there is a crown for the martyrdom. Any believer can be rewarded for his behavior, but the martyrs, they are getting more. Tolerating pain for the sake of Christ became a spiritual gift, and this is not something new. If I listen to what St. Paul said in his epistle to the Philippians, for to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, for his sake. Anybody can, how you can take this? Suffering is a gift? Yes, suffering for the sake of the loved one. Why? Because he suffered for me before he asked me to accept suffering for him. Also, in his epistle to the Romans, St. Paul said, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. If Christianity is love, the martyrdom for Christianity is the highest level of love. If Christianity is all about love, so to offer yourself a sacrifice, this is the greatest level or the highest level of love. Saint Clement of Alexandria said, martyrdom is not just shedding your blood and not only confessing your faith of Christ, of Jesus Christ, but the practice of the fullness of love. Martyrdom is not shedding blood. Martyrdom is not confessing your faith in Christ, but practicing the fullness of love. This is reflection for what the Bible taught us. There is no love other than you put your life for. You put your life, and this is the greatest sign of love. The second thing Christianity taught us, that we are heavenly creatures. Our destination is not earth. Our destination is in heaven. Heaven is our optimal spiritual objective, our destination to always be with God. And this is very important. If we care about earth, we'll feel bad about persecution and martyrdom. But if we are heavenly creature, then this person who are persecuting or killing us is giving us to reach to our destination. I want to just, and I'm not making it very simple, but this is the reality. I am struggling on earth to reach to heaven, and somebody will come and send me in a shortcut to heaven with a crown. Do you think I have to love or hate him? I have to love him, right? Shortcut with a crown. That's great. In his epistle to the Hebrew, this all died. He talked about the forefathers of faith, died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. All our fathers who were faithful to God and lived by faith, they confessed that they are strangers on earth. In his epistle to Corinthians also, St. Paul said, so we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, yes, will please rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. So if I am here in the body, I am absent from the Lord. And if I'm absent for the body, I am present with the Lord. Which one you want to have? Which one will be always with you? Number three, why Christians, they tolerate persecution and martyrdom? Because Christianity taught the believer that he should desire heaven. Number one, that it is a spiritual gift. Number two, our destination is in heaven. Number three, heaven is our desire. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the cross Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Our citizenship is in. Every time we baptize a child, what we used to say to him? You came American, and now we made you heavenly. So our citizenship is in heaven, and this is what we should always keep in mind, and this is what will affect all our behaviors. That's why we desire heaven. If you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on this above, not on things on the earth. Christianity made us to always desire heaven and think heavenly. Number four is divine support. Our people, they tolerate pain because of the divine support they are getting from God. I cannot forget the story of this lady saint. She was pregnant, and according to the Roman law, they cannot kill a pregnant woman. And she was condemned as Christian, because when the Roman people, they judge Christian, the Christian will stand in front of the emperor or the ruler and say, I am Christian. And all the Roman people, they will scream loud, death to the Christian. Death to the Christian. So he sent her to die, or sent anybody to die. And this lady was pregnant, and they have to keep her under observation till she delivered, then they kill her. And the soldiers saw her in pain and suffering a lot while she is in labor pain. And they start to have jokes on her. If you don't tolerate the labor pain, which is natural pain, labor pain, we call it natural pain. How you will tolerate to be headed or anything of the torture they do? And the answer was very strong. Labor pain is a natural pain. I have to struggle myself on it. But the pain of persecution or martyrdom, I'm getting a divine support. Those people, I can assure you, they see, and this is the next point, they see spiritual visions. They see heaven is open. That's why they stand strong and they accept to be killed without even scared. Many times we saw people killing Christians, they are scared and the people are not scared. And I will never forget the picture or the icon somebody wrote for the 21 martyrs of Egyptians in Libya. The people who kills hide their faces, and the people who are killed, they are like lions, strong and not afraid for giving their life for the sake of Christ. Here, if you can read this verse, it shows the divine support. Jesus didn't hide from us that we're gonna be persecuted on earth and gonna be hated for a simple reason. If you aren't from this world, the world will love you, but you are not from this world, the world will not love you. But he is promising us not only to support us when we face the martyrdom, but he is supporting us even when we are questioned before rulers. Number five of the reasons why the Christian tolerates persecution and martyrdom, the unity of the church as members of the one body, member of the body of Christ. And this is very important. The church always, like the statement you hear now, shows that we are all one body, and we feel the pain and sufferings of our brethren who God granted them the crown of martyrdom. Rather than this, there is a financial support definitely for the families. Number six is the spiritual visions, and we hear this a lot on the stories of the saints. Saint Mark, they tortured him in the streets of Alexandria. They throw him in the prison, and he will see a vision to support him. And he heals back. Many of the saints, they went through this. God will send them an angel. God will send them a messenger till the final stage when Jesus will appear to them, and he will tell him, appreciate your love, appreciate your tolerance, and you're gonna be with me. And then you see the ruler is ordering him to be headed. God supported the martyrs with his spiritual visions to know what he prepared for them. One of the famous stories is martyrs of Sabastia. The martyrs of Sabastia, they killed them, as I told you, they like to torture more than to kill. So they put them in ice water, and they put them in a boiling water. This is to cause circulatory failure. Very cold water, very hot water. And they start to die. One of them is scared, and one of the soldiers saw that each one dies, there is an angel to put a crown on the head of the person who departed. And the guy, he screamed, the guy, one of the martyrs got scared, and one of the soldiers who was watching the crowning process, he screamed, I'm Christian," and he started to jump on the hot water and cold water till he got died and he got crowned. The crown the other guy lost. So God was supporting us, as I'm talking in one concept. We are heavenly, we are taking this as a gift, and we are special for God. He loves us and he prepares for us mansions in heaven. That's why he doesn't want us to attach ourselves to earth. Finally, I want to put in your heart this statement. I'm a Christian, I am a martyr. I'm a Christian, I am a martyr. And sometimes martyr will take the meaning of witness. Witness. And trust me, there is martyr before somebody will kill you, but there is martyr before piece of chocolate in fasting, and there is a martyr before piece of steak in a fasting. There are martyr before somebody insulted you and you didn't answer back and told him, thank you, God bless you. There are martyr who kills his ego and I should be this, I should be that. If you don't go through this training, you cannot shed your blood. I'm telling you the truth. If you don't know how to witness the Lord and to be martyred for the earthly life, you cannot reach the high stage of offering yourself as a sacrifice for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why if in Egypt now they say Christian is a project of a martyr, I'm making it simpler. I'm saying I'm Christian, I am. Huh? I want to hear you. This is a practical part of the sermon. I am a Christian, then I am a martyr. Okay? Deny yourself. This is the first thing. Deny yourself. Don't do your will and try to give peace to the people around you. Not be my will, but let it be your will. I'm Christian, I'm a martyr. The martyrdom became a desire or a wish. The people, they love to be killed for the name of Christ. And we heard that the ruler decided to kill all the Christian in the Manhur. There were 60,000 Christian. They told them to come to Alexandria. And the guys told him, give us time to go and dress the most expensive clothes we have. Not because we are coming to be martyr and coming to you, but because we are coming to see, to go to our Lord, to heaven. So in the early age of the church, when the Christian hear there is a ruler kills the Christians, they run to this ruler because they want to be crowned with the crown of the martyrdom. So it became a desire and a wish. And it shows a courage. Martyrdom is basically you are facing death. And there is nothing can scare human being connected to earth than death. Because if life, my life is connected to earth and my plans on earth and everything, like you go to the doctor and he tells you bad news about your health, then you feel bad. Why? You are thinking of, I'm gonna depart. Imagine martyrdom doesn't take that long, it's faster. But for people to face death and to face this, it's a courage. They showed how the Christians are very courageous, that they tremble over death. They are not scared from death. Martyrdom also became a way for preaching. The more people die for the name of Christ, the more the Christ's name will be known and the people will believe in him. And this is a fact. If you see how Christianity is spread all over the world, this can take a topic. It is based on persecution. The more they persecute the Christian, the more they spread, not denying Christ, but preaching the word and the name of Christ to everyone. You can see this from the book of Acts. You can see this from the church life. Every time they persecute Christian, they spread all over around the countries, carrying the word of Christ to everybody, even during the moments of martyrdom. Martyrdom also became a witness for the truth of the Christian faith. If you are not sure of your faith, you're gonna die for it? Very simple question. If you are not sure for the faith you believe in, you're gonna die for it? You can put your life for it? No. But because we have people, they put their life, they die for the sake, for the name of Christ, this means our faith is proven by the blood of the martyrs. That's why we say always, the blood of the martyrs became the seed of the faith. Martyrdom also became a proof for the Christian virtues. There are so many types of martyrs. Martyrs for the faith, martyrs for the dogma, martyrs for the purity, martyrs for so many things. So if I'm talking about any virtue like purity, there are so many examples of people they accepted to shed their blood for their purity. I will tell you just one story. There was a pure girl, and she refused to worship idols. And one of the torturing techniques they used before killing her, they put her in a prostitution house. And one of the Christian soldiers heard about this lady, and he decided to go and save her. So he went and asked to go to this girl. And when he went, he told her, "I am your brother, and I wanna save you from this place. You wear my clothes, and I'm gonna stay in your place, and you can escape. And when they discover this, you will be already out of this place." She accepted his offer, but when the ruler came to know the trick this guy did, he ordered him to be headed, to be killed. So she ran to the place where they want to kill him and told him, "I agreed with you to protect my purity, but I didn't agree with you to take away my crown of martyrdom," and they killed both of them. So here, if they don't believe in the importance of purity, they will not even definitely do this. That's why I will conclude with the rank of the martyrs in the Coptic Church. No matter how great is the saint, the martyrs will come before them. And this is to show you how the church recognize the martyrs, they reached the fullness of love to their Christ. So if we pray, for example, we put the martyrs before the saints. And not only that, we celebrate the feast of the commemoration of the martyrdom of those saints, remembering what they did for their love for Christ our God. And we celebrate their feasts, and we have special glorification hymns for them, and we set them like candles of light to show us how to shed our blood, not even by actual blood, but accepting to struggle for the sake of Christ. Then I want to just conclude by repeating this beginning of this slide. I am Christian, then I am a martyr. I am a Christian, then I am martyr. Martyr means I give up the pleasures on life of this on this earth. I give up willingly the pleasures of life on this earth, and glory be to God forever. Amen.